Guys, you heard Pastor Jennifer say a second ago, we're going to start a brand new series today, and I'm going to share the title with you. Actually excited about the title. Today, we're going to title this series, Crooks of the Cross. Amen. So we're going to talk to you today of series number one, rather Crooks of the Cross. And guys, what I want to do today, I want to start this series out by asking you a couple of questions. Number one, have you ever noticed that as Christians, we often resist the very God that we say we trust? Amen. All right, number two, I need to show in your hands on this one. Have you ever had an internal battle? Whether in your head, I love you raising your hand, I'm not even finished. Whether in your head or in your heart, and you found yourself resisting God. Let me see your hands. Mm-hmm. All right, for those of you that didn't raise your hand, guess what? You just resisted God. Yeah. Come on, guys. We find ourselves resisting God all the time. Can you say amen? Now, here's the thing that makes matters worse. We know the Word. We got in the Word, and guess what? The Word got in us. And all of a sudden, we still find ourselves fighting God and resisting God, especially when it comes to forgiving and forgetting. We want to hold on and harbor things. Come on, I wish I had some help today. Instead of forgive and forget. But see, when we find ourselves fighting, it's a futile fight every time we fight against God. Can you say amen? Amen. See, within all of us, there is an internal battle. Can I get a witness, somebody? Yes, and there's three things I want to hit on quickly that we all battle against. It is living, giving, and forgiving. Watch this. Living, we know that the Bible says we need to live His way, not our way. We know the Bible talks about giving because it says we need to give Him our time, our treasure, and our talent. But if we're not careful, we want to keep part of that to ourselves. Okay. Come on, shake your head this way. Let me know you're still with me. And finally, forgiving, we know according to the Bible, we're supposed to forgive others because He first forgave us. But see, the problem is, watch this, is that people who don't go to church are watching us. People we work with, go to school with, hang out with, they're watching us. And they see by our actions that we are all show and no go. Wow. They see that we cannot practice what we preach and that we can talk the talk. But when the rubber meets the road, we just can't walk the walk. They see that we say one thing, but yet we do another, and then we wonder why we can't reach them. Guys, can I give you some divine revelation? How we're acting is not helping us, is hurting us, and they have a word to describe us. Let me give you a hint. It's not holy. It's hypocrite. Come on, can I get a witness, somebody? Now watch this. We wonder why we can't reach them, and the simple reason is this. We'll never reach them if we do the same thing that they do. We must do something differently in order to make an impact in their life. Can you say amen?
So today we're going to start by looking at the final weeks of Jesus' life, his journey, if you will, up to the cross. And yes, we're heading into Easter, but it's important that we look at this Passover time, the time leading up into Jesus' arrest, leading up into Jesus' crucifixion. And there's some characters. We're gonna focus on three characters. Over the next 3 weeks, we're going to look at three different characters. Today, we're going to focus on one. Three characters whose lives intersected with his. And they all had their own agenda. Yeah. They all had their own agenda. Like us, they wanted it their way right away.
Come on.
Instead of God's way, right? Sometimes we fall into that trap of doing that. So we're going to look at their lives. We're going to look at how their lives intersected Jesus's. We're going to be able to have our eyes open to his journey to the cross. And that's going to make Easter a whole lot more real to us on Resurrection Sunday. But it's also going to teach us a lot about ourselves, too, because there's a little bit of us inside of each of them. Yeah. Or should I say a little bit of them inside of each of us, right? And so we want to examine what that is so that we can recognize it so that we could stay far away from being that.
You know, the crazy thing is there's a little crook inside of all of us. Don't shout me down when I'm preaching good, somebody.
Just dead silence.
Amen.
Right there.
Hey, look, yeah. We're going to see in their stories that they all resisted God and how futile it is to fight against him. But listen, guys, before you and I get all holy and high-minded, we got to realize that we are no different than them. Our stories are just like their stories, and we still fight against God every time God expects us to do something and we don't do it. We got to realize today that fighting against God and resisting God is not the way to live, especially if we say we trust God and then we do something else. That is called a self-destructive behavior. Can you say amen?
Right. So we're going to look, first character we're going to look at is in our series is Caiaphas, the high priest, right? Joseph Caiaphas, actually, is who we're going to take a look at. We're going to give you some background information so you can kind of understand where he went wrong and understand what was going on with him and how he would be kind of labeled that crook and that hypocrite on the way to the cross. He was a high priest during Jesus' day. Now, if we know what a high priest does and what he did and what his position was, his position as a high priest was to be that one that would enter into the temple, that would make sacrifices for God's people, that would atone for the sins of God's people. So kind of keep that in the back of your mind, what he was called and commissioned and appointed to do for God. Okay, he was the high priest. He ruled and reigned from 18 AD to 36 AD, so he had an 18-year reign. And the reason why that's significant, he was the most powerful person in ancient Israel, but the reason why it's important to see that he had an 18-year reign is that's a long reign for a high priest. And what's more than that is by the time he got to this position, the position of high priest was always one that you had to be in a bloodline to be able to get there. In a bloodline, it was all about. It wasn't a political position, but by the time he got there, it was all about politics. So what does that tell us? It tells us that if he was in that position for 18 years, he was a career politician and he was really good at it. Yeah. He was extremely manipulative, and there was something to do with this power. He was the most powerful person in ancient Israel, but you're going to see the power that he had, it really didn't measure up to the fact that he was a high priest. He was a very political person.
He was a bridge, the commentaries say, that connected ancient Israel to Rome, the powerhouse of the world. And more importantly, he was part of a prominent family of high priests that actually controlled the temple. And by controlling the temple, what we mean is he controlled his power, he controlled his politics, he controlled his prosperity and the very religion of the temple itself. He is from a long line of high priests. We find out that he was had a family dynasty starting with his father-in-law that we read about in the Bible named Annas, who was a former high priest. Then Caiaphas was high priest, and he had five brothers-in-law that were also high priests that served in the temple as well. Now watch this. Since they controlled the temple and its wealth, commentaries say they were very, very wealthy. This family ruled as high priests for about 40 years. And we find out that they actually set in motion something called the temple tax. Now watch this. This temple tax was actually for every single Jewish person scattered around the ancient world that when they would travel back to Jerusalem, they had to bring a temple tax with them that was equivalent to 2 days' worth of wages. So when they traveled back, they actually put this money into the temple. Now, the tax was bringing in, according to commentaries, millions and millions of dollars every single year into this 32-acre piece of prime property located in Jerusalem called the temple. Think about that. Millions of dollars every single year. The money that was being poured into this place actually got the attention of all the surrounding Roman provinces. They didn't like that money was leaving their country and going and being put into a temple to a god that they did not worship. Now watch this. Caiaphas being the character that we're talking about today. Caiaphas had power, he had position, and he had prestige. Why? Because he ruled and reigned over the temple and its wealth. Now, I love what Pastor Jennifer said just a second ago, because Caiaphas was perfectly, watch this, perfectly positioned for power and for prosperity. Why? Not because of bloodline, but because of an appointment from Rome. The priesthood now was a political position. Now watch this. Caiaphas was top dog, unchallenged and undefeated, until a Jewish carpenter turned rabbi stepped out of the background into the forefront. And we know the man that I'm speaking about, according to the Bible, was Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Can you say amen? Now, I love the fact that Caiaphas was intimidated by Jesus from the get-go. Because as soon as the Son of God showed up on the scene, he showed up with power and with popularity. Can you say amen? And this put him in a position to draw large crowds that would follow him. Now, here's the problem with the crowds. Watch this. The crowds personally, they were eyewitnesses of his miracles. They saw the blind see. They saw him heal the sick. They saw him divinely deliver people from devils. Can you say amen? They saw Jesus raise the dead and feed thousands and thousands of people with some saltines and some sardines. Can you say amen? Now, I love the fact that everywhere that Jesus went, he drew crazy crowds. And here lies the problem with the crowds. These crowds were a threat to Caiaphas and also a threat to Rome itself. Why? Because crowds meant revolts. Crowds meant rebellion. Crowds meant resistance and even war itself. And that is the last thing Caiaphas as a political figure wanted, because he knew that whoever controlled the crowds controlled the people. Whoever controlled the people controlled the power. And Caiaphas did not want to lose his position. That meant that Rome would come in and take everything away from him and strip him of that position. Now, here's another reason that they did not care for Jesus. Jesus told it like it was. The Savior never sugarcoated anything. Can you say amen? I love the fact that Jesus told it like it was. He shot straight from the hip, and he never, ever watered anything down. Case in point, let's look at the screen. This is Jesus' words. Now, keep in mind, this is not speaking to some random people, but this was speaking to the religious leaders of the day. Here's what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 23 and verse 33. You snakes. Come on, man. That's good stuff. You brood of vipers. In other words, you family of snakes. How will you escape being condemned to hell? Remember, guys, these were not random people. These were the religious people in their heyday. And I love the fact that Jesus walked up to him, looked him in the eye, and said, you're clean on the inside, or outside rather, but you're dirty on the inside. They were all show and no go. Come on, guys. They were all about the shout and the clout, but they could not walk it out. Can I get a witness? Follow me. He looked at them and he called them on the carpet. He said, you got religion, but it ain't good enough. You need a right relationship with God, or you will bust hell wide open. Can you say amen? That's exactly what Jesus said. And once again, Caiaphas had a major problem with Jesus. Not because of the crowds. Not because of a conversation with Jesus. Or not even because of a confrontation with Jesus. But the major problem that he had with Jesus was his compassion. Watch this. His compassion is what led Jesus to raise Lazarus, his good friend, from the dead. And after this miracle took place, they could no longer try and discredit Jesus. They could no longer point a finger at him and say that he was a fake or a phony. Why? Because this miracle was so powerful. Because the crowd was an eyewitness to what took place. And I love the fact that, how many know that God, you've heard me say it over and over again, God is never late, help me somebody, seldom early, but what? always right on time. Do you realize when Jesus and his disciples were out preaching the word, that that word got to them from Mary and Martha that Lazarus was sick and about to die? Jesus didn't drop what he was doing and go to Lazarus' side. He purposely waited 4 days until he died. Now, what made this miracle so powerful was not that Lazarus died, but that Lazarus was dead and buried. He was in a tomb, sealed. And all of a sudden, the Savior, our righteous Redeemer and Resurrector, come on, guys, showed up on the scene right in the nick of time. He walked up to Mary and Martha and said, "Where's he at?" He said, "Lord, you don't want to know where he is." He said, "He's been in the grave for 4 days, and you know what? He stinks pretty bad right now." Come on, guys, rigor mortis had set in. His body began to decay and break down. But I love the fact that Jesus said, "Roll the stone away." Watch this. Jesus looked inside this tomb. Commentaries say they were bodies that were literally stacked up on each other, buried in a cave. And Jesus called him by name. He had to. Because if he would have just said, "Come forth," every dead body, come on, guys, would have got up out of that tomb and walked out. But instead, he had to call him by name. I'm here today to tell you that when he called him by name, the Bible says he who was dead got up, and they had to loose him of his grave clothes and let him go. Can you say amen? But watch this. When Lazarus was resurrected, Jesus' crowds began to grow like never ever before, and Caiaphas knew that his plan of trying to discredit him was not working. Why? Because all of these people, one more time, were eyewitnesses of his miracles. Plus, they knew Lazarus personally because they lived in Bethany with him. Now watch this. Speaking of the crowds that Caiaphas hated, let's look at what the word says. The Bible says in John chapter 12 and verse 17, "Now the crowd," here's what he hated, "the crowd that was with him when he called Lazarus from the tomb and raised him from the dead, continue to" what? "Spread the word." Watch this. They were telling everybody what Jesus did. The crowds that Caiaphas hated was not only expanding, they were now evangelizing. Can you say amen? John 12, 18 says, "Many people, because they heard that he performed this sign, went out to meet him." They weren't staying put. They were stepping out to meet the Prince of Peace. Once again, these crowds were killing Caiaphas because they were growing by the day. John 12, 19, let's look at the screen. The Bible says, "So the Pharisees said to one another," see, this is getting us nowhere. What was trying to disprove him, trying to discredit him? Then they went on to say, "Look, the whole world is gone after him." You can't stop God. Come on, somebody. There's a scripture in Mark 1:28 that says Jesus' fame, come on, he was famous, can I get a witness? His fame spread through the region of Galilee. Here's the issue. The Pharisees were control freaks. And what was freaking them out was that the control they thought they had was literally slipping through their fingers. Next verse, John 11, 47. "Then the chief priests and the Pharisees called a meeting of the Sanhedrin." Here's the importance of, about this scripture. The Sanhedrin was the highest Jewish court, basically the Supreme Court of the day. It made up about 70 elders that sat on this board, mostly the Sadducees, who, by the way, did not believe in a literal resurrection, even though Lazarus was just raised from the dead.
And Caiaphas was part of
that. And Caiaphas was part of this group. I love it when God proves people wrong. Can you say amen?
Yeah.
Now, here's what happened. You figure that the Sanhedrin was there, and Caiaphas, the high priest, called a meeting with all of the head honchos of the day, consisting of the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, and the Sanhedrin. This group hated each other. They couldn't stand to be in the same room with one another. They could never, ever agree on anything except trying to stop Jesus.
Yeah.
Now, to bring that in modern time, it would be equivalent of the Republicans, the Democrats, the House and the Senate and the Supreme Court all voting on something and saying yes or no in unison. It ain't going to happen. Come on, guys. Right? That's equivalent of this day. What happened? Now, get this. John 11:47. Here's what it says. They said, what are we accomplishing? Here is this man performing many signs. Remember, the blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk, the mute talk. This was a fulfillment of prophecy out of Isaiah. Mm-hmm. Then the next verse says, John 11:48 says this. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him. And then, watch this, here's what happened. They started having thoughts. Here's what commentaries say. They knew within their heart of hearts that this Jewish carpenter turned rabbi that worked signs and wonders and did mighty miracles was somebody that they needed to embrace. But here's the problem. In order for them to embrace him, they had to let go of control that they were embracing. What was the control that they were used to having? Watch this. Their power, their prestige, and their position. Listen. They knew what to do, but they were not willing to pay the price. John 11:48, the second part says this. Here's their fear. The Romans will come and take away both our temple and our nation. Here's the key. It was all about them. They weren't worried about anybody else. They were worried about keeping their position. Guys, let me ask you a question. How many of you know that when we decide to follow Jesus, it's going to cost us something? Man, that was a weak amen. I wish I had a better one. Amen. When we follow Jesus, it's going to cost us something. Make no mistake about it. It might cost us our friends. Maybe even our family. It is an investment when you and I follow the Lord. Can you say amen? Amen. Watch this. It's going to cost us our comfort, but we still get to keep our character. Can you say amen? See, listen, following Jesus is not convenient. Mm-hmm. It's going to cost us something. Let me give an example. Man, we work all week. And we don't want to give up our weekend. I'm about to preach. Get ready. Or for that matter, the rest of our time. We don't want to give up the rest of the week for the Lord. And you know, we say, well, Sunday's my only day off. And that's my family day. That's my fun day. I want to spend time with my family. Well, guess what? You can. Wake up early, come to church with your family, come on, God's family, then go out on the lake, the beach, or whatever, and have your fun day on Sunday. But put God first, because when you give God your best, which is the first day, he'll bless the rest. Can you say amen? Amen. Guys, you got to realize today that there's times that we don't want to get involved, because getting involved means taking our time away. Listen, we don't want to get involved in a small group because it takes up too much of our time, and apparently our time is too valuable for the Lord. But you got to realize when we give our time to God, God blesses us and gives us even more time for him. Mm-hmm. Come on, you can say amen. I can see you. I just can't hear you today. Watch this. John 11:49-50 says this. Then one of them named Caiaphas, here's our key character, who was the high priest that year, spoke up, and here's what he said. You know nothing at all. You don't realize that it is better for you that one man die for the people than that the whole nation perish. Now, here's the problem with this verse. He actually sounds like he's concerned with the people. It's not the case. He's not concerned with them at all. He's only concerned for his own benefit. He was concerned about losing his power, his prestige, and his position. He wasn't concerned with the people. Why? Because, as Pastor Jennifer said, beginning in the message, he was in this position for 18 years, and he wasn't about to give it up. Because if he lost his position, that meant that he would also lose his paycheck. And he wasn't willing to give it up for the Lord. Commentaries say this man was super wealthy, and the last thing he wanted to do is lose his paycheck. Watch this. If he lost his paycheck, that meant that he would also lose his position, which means he would also lose his palace. Let's go to the screen. Look, here's a reenactment, or a model, rather, of where he lived. He did not want to give that place up. Can I tell you, he was all about the money and the mansion instead of about the Messiah. Can you say amen? Amen. See, one more time, he was not willing to pay the price. But let's be honest today. We all, from the pulpit all the way to the sound booth, we all have a little bit of Caiaphas in us this morning. I venture to say that all of us have a little bit of crooks of the cross inside of us. Why? Because we only want Jesus on our terms. Are you hearing me today? We only want Jesus when it's convenient for us. We only want Jesus our way, not his way. Like Caiaphas, we are more concerned with our comfort than our character. Like Caiaphas, we are selfish, not selfless. Like Caiaphas, if we're not careful, we are always about our position instead of being about his mission. You can say amen or oh me, I'm still here.
Mm-hmm. You know, speaking about Caiaphas' mission, I want to kind of find an airport to land here. But before we do, I want to just share with you some things that I saw in this story that, surprise, are a little bit different than what Anthony saw in this. And as you know, somebody once described Pastor and I as he's the Bible and I'm the footnotes, or vice versa, whatever. Often we'll look at scripture and something will jump out at one of us, and then we'll talk about it and we'll see something different. And while Anthony saw this and saw the prestige and the power and the position, and we began talking about that, you know that Pastor, he loves his rhymes, right? He's a poet and he knows it, right? And we all know it. He's a rapper for Jesus, right? And he didn't. I used to say he missed his calling. He didn't miss his calling. He just brings it to the pulpit, and so you know, upon talking about that, we talked about that oftentimes we can be like Caiaphas in that that we too can want Jesus until it interferes with that promotion or that position or that paycheck was a P that we added upon that in his palace. And yes, and you were very happy that I added those P's to your part. There you go, P's to your part. And I'm a poet, yeah. And hanging out with you for 22 years. But one of the things that I saw that was so unbelievably huge to me, and I want to make sure that we don't miss them, is the fact that if we can go back to John 11, 49 and 50, I think it's so important that we see this and that we remember, and I underline high priest. Caiaphas was a high priest. His position that we're talking about was to make atonement for the sins of God's people. This was Passover time. And during this time, his position, his calling, what he did for, if he was in that position for 18 years, then around about this time, he would be finding a Passover lamb, a lamb without spot or blemish to use for the atonement of the people's sins. So as a high priest, that was his job, that was his position, that was his calling. In other words, he was called to hear from God. His job was to have ears tuned in to God, and yet he couldn't recognize God's only son, Jesus, standing right in front of his face. That to me is quite concerning, because that means that any of us can find ourselves in a position where we start out maybe doing something for God, and somewhere along the way, we have no ability to hear him any longer. Or we are so clouded by our own agenda that we think we're on the right path. Or somehow we convince ourselves we're on the right path. Or maybe we just don't care whether or not we're on the right path because we have our own path that we're more concerned with. So when I saw this story, I was concerned with the fact that this high priest, who was used to and was supposed to be listening out for God, wasn't able to hear God's agenda at all.
Right.
That somewhere along the way, he stopped checking his heart. Whether he checked his heart ever at all, there's really no indication that he ever really was on the right path. But the fact of the matter is, we look at this and we see that he says these words, "You don't realize that it's better for you that one man die for the people than that the whole nation perish." And I love that Pastor just said that right here it sounds like he really cares about the people. I mean, he's sitting in this meeting. Maybe his feet are propped up. Maybe he, you know, thinks he's the deal, and he makes it sound like he cares about the people, and really all he cares about is himself. But here's what I love. I love the fact that regardless of where his heart was, God says, it don't matter. I'm going to use you anyways.
Come on.
Because it doesn't matter what man's agenda is. Right. I have a plan, and I'm going to get it done with or without you. And so I love that whether it's Balaam's donkey or whoever it has to be, God will have his way. I love the fact that this man who was not listening to God, this man who was literally out for his own evil agenda, was literally being used by God. I picture God up in heaven sometimes just playing chess with us. Going, all right, you going that way? Checkmate. And just having his way anyways. Because the fact is that unknowingly, God was using his mouth, his evil mouth, to declare a divine truth.
Yeah.
That he spoke the word, one man should die for the people rather than the whole nation to perish. The cool part is he's sitting there going, we need to kill Jesus because he's fixing to take my life away from me.
Right.
But what was cool is that God said and used that mouth to speak words that were literally God's divine plan.
Right.
And he was speaking that divine truth. He was literally prophesying. An evil man was prophesying God's truth.
Come on.
Do you get that?
That's what the Bible says. Yeah.
Prophesying God's plan. He may have not known it, but he was. He was prophesying God's plan for Jesus' death and his plan to save the world from their sins. Listen to this. Not only that, but unbeknownst to him, he was prophesying about saving not only the Jewish nation, but the Gentile nation.
Right.
If you are a non-Jew, would you raise your hand, please? Mm-hmm. Say, praise the Lord.
Yeah, praise
Amen.
The Lord. Thank God.
And all who would call upon and submit to Christ. Let's take a look at this verse, John 11:51-52. He did not say this on his own, but as high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus would die for the Jewish nation. Mm-hmm. And not only for that nation, but also for the scattered children of God, the Gentiles,
come on,
to bring them together and make them one. See, this evil man had an agenda, but God said, that's all right, I'm going to use you anyways. You don't even know it, but I am going to have you think that you're in control, but really, I'm going to be controlling you.
Come on.
You are going to be pushing my agenda to put Jesus on that cross, because you're not going to take his life. He's going to lay his life down, and we're going to see that in just a second.
Yeah.
But he's going to go to that cross, and you're going to think that you have won, but see, I'm just using you. You're just a little pawn in my game.
Yeah.
I'm going to use you, and I'm going to get Jesus to the cross, because like you prophesied out of your own mouth, he is going to,
yeah.
Are you with me?
Yeah.
He is going to change the world.
That's right.
And save not only the nation, but all who call upon his name. Hebrews 5:8-9 says this, Jesus was God's son from the things that he suffered, God qualified him as a perfect high priest. Guys, you know what fries me is the fact that here is this high priest. And God himself sent the ultimate perfect high priest standing in front of him. And he was so clouded by his own judgment, by his own agenda, that he couldn't see the ultimate high priest standing right in front of him. Guys, if we don't keep our hearts checked, we can be in a position where we think we got him. I can't tell you how many people I've sat in front of and said, listen, I'm really concerned. I'm really concerned. I haven't seen you in a while. I'm really concerned. I feel like, you know, we always say around here that if you're not feeling connected, it's because you disconnected somewhere along the way. Come on. And you know what they'll say? Don't worry about me. Me and Jesus, we're tight. Are you? Are you? Does Jesus know you're tight? This scares me. Because this tells me right here that we can be in a position, that we can be in a ministry position, that we can be walking around going, me and Jesus, we tight. And still be missing it. And not even see him standing in our face.
Come on, come on.
It says that God qualified him as a perfect high priest, and he became the source of eternal salvation for all those who would obey him. Ephesians 4 and 4 said, there is one body and one spirit. There is one hope in which we were called. That means that this evil man was used by God to prophesy out of his own mouth. Here is what I need us all to realize. Please be very careful that you and I are not walking around going, if God's using me, I must be right with God.
Wow. Come on.
Good. Really good.
That's good.
I love you. Because clearly God can use you and he can use me and we can be totally off.
Yeah.
Some of you are going to go, well, don't tell me that. That screws me up. There's a spirit of God that lives within us that we are supposed to be consulting with daily.
That's right.
Check me. Mm-hmm. That's why David said, search my heart.
Right.
Search my heart. You know what's in here.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what evil thing is in there. You know the way I justify my own sin. You know the way I always tell you it's his fault when I know that it's mine. You know that I always can find fault in others and not in mine. Lord, you know that I judge myself by my own intention and other people by their actions. You know. The fact of the matter is Caiaphas lost his way. He was manipulative, and he was all out to kill Jesus. He was all out to preserve his power and his prestige and his paycheck and his palace and his position. But let's get one thing straight. God's plans will never be thwarted by God's by man's agenda. Our agenda will never, ever get in the way. Even if God has to hit the GPS and have it reroute, we will get there.
Right.
He will get there, and hopefully we'll get our junk together that we get back on the route and get there too. Sometimes we mess up, but the goal is to understand that there are times where we can find ourselves in that place like Caiaphas where we go, oh my Lord, God was using me all along, but my heart wasn't right. My heart wasn't right. I don't want to ever stand on this stage. I don't ever want to be in a position of ministry and be doing it for the wrong reasons. Have I ever been? Absolutely. Yes. Did I mean to be? No. Have I ever been in a place where I was doing it for the wrong reasons and my heart was not right, but I was just too tired to care? Uh-huh. And then is it my job to peel back and to get my stuff right before I step back? Yes. But it's our job to check our heart.
That's right.
It's our job to understand that if we call ourselves Christians, that it's our job to constantly check our heart. Take a look at this verse right here. John 11 and 53 says this, from that day they plotted to take his life. But see, here's the thing. We know that they didn't take his life. John 10 and 18 says this, no one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. Guys, we're going to wrap up with this. Here's what I want you to understand. He said those words. He said those words. He spoke out of his mouth. He prophesied without even realizing it that one man should die instead of the whole nation. Oh, that sounds real noble. He prophesied it, and then this is what happened. The Jewish leaders came to arrest Jesus at Passover, and he would need to be questioned. He would need to go before somebody, and somebody would need to rule upon his fate. So here's what they had to do. They had to bring him before the Sanhedrin. Remember, the council, the religious council, right? He had to be tried in front of somebody. He had to go before him, and then he had to also go before they brought together a bunch of false witnesses to bring against Jesus. And guess who they also called upon for Jesus to stand in front of for him to be tried? Caiaphas himself. So they call him in, but guess where they call him into? They call him into Caiaphas's house. He is the high priest. He is the most powerful person in all of the land. So they call in Jesus, and he's going to be tried. And he's brought in to Caiaphas's house. You can look at this real quick, and we'll wrap it up. These are the steps that he walked. These are the steps that he was beaten, spat upon, pushed up to get to Caiaphas's house. And Pastor already showed you what his massive palace looked like. Show you the next picture, please. Those steps going up into that massive palace. Jesus was being brought in to be tried because why? He had an agenda, kill Jesus. Meanwhile, Jesus was going, and he was going to begin the process of laying down his life as the Passover lamb, as our high priest. Going into the home, by the way, of the high priest, they couldn't recognize God's ultimate high priest. So he goes up into that place, and then he spends the night in a dungeon. This is pictures of what they believe is where he spent the night. He was held in that place. That was his darkest hour. That was where he was looking forward to his death because, you see, he knew that he was born to die for the sins of all people. So he spent the night there. I want you to just kind of think about this just for a second. Caiaphas, the man that was literally in a position because he could hear from God, is housing the Son of God in his basement to take his life. He had truth in his house, but couldn't see truth to save his life. So he's got Jesus in his basement, and he's putting together this group of people that will basically lie and try to find something to accuse him with. And after all of that, I want you to understand this is his darkest hour. Not only was he in pain because he was already being beaten and spat upon and hurt and his beard being ripped out of his face, all of that was already going on. But outside of that place was this place right here. And on one of the floors right here was a courtyard. And on this courtyard right here is where Peter was. You know, his buddy, his friend. The one that sliced off the ear of the soldier and said, "You ain't taking Jesus because I got his back. I've seen him do miracles. I've walked with him. I've talked with him. I know who he is. Jesus, don't worry. I won't leave you. I won't forsake you. I'm with you. I believe in you. And nothing's going to get between." And then all of a sudden, here Peter is. Jesus within an earshot, somebody asks him, "Hey, aren't you with that Jesus guy?" And what does Peter do? "Huh? I don't know him. What are you talking about?" Not once, not twice, but three times. And so Jesus not only is in his darkest hour, losing everything being stripped from him, but he's hearing the very people that do believe in him deny him, his friends. You ever have a friend like that? So if that didn't rip his heart out all the more, I just need you to understand, it was there on that courtyard. And just a side note, I don't know if you can see this, but right above that if you look at the very top of your screen, you'll see a big building with a blue roof. That's because that's now and that's today. And that is because in that place, in that same location, there is something to commemorate Peter denying Jesus. It's now St. Peter's Church. But first, there is a little statue of the cock at the top that crowed three times when he was denied. And you see Peter sitting there with the people with his hands out. I don't know him. So that stands there today. And then here is St. Peter's Cathedral, or the church that stands in its place right above Caiaphas's house there, where Jesus was brought before him. And they were trying to find something to accuse him so that they could put him to death like Caiaphas wanted. That is what stands there in its place. Guys, I want you to understand today that despite false witnesses, nothing was found to warrant Jesus' death. Caiaphas finally stood up, and you can take that picture down. Caiaphas finally stood up and looked at Jesus dead in the face, again, looking truth dead in the face. One high priest to another, not recognizing him, looked him dead in the face and said this, "I charge you under oath by the living God." I find that humorous, by the way. "I charge you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." And Jesus replied as directly as he could, and he said, "You have said so." You see, Caiaphas asked all the right questions. He even got the right answer. But he was not listening with his heart. He was listening for an agenda.
Right, right.
And the minute that Jesus spoke those words, all he heard was blasphemy. That's all I needed. I needed you to say that you were the Son of God. And that's blasphemy, so you can be killed. And it wasn't enough to have him go to death. And the fact of the matter is Jews couldn't legally execute prisoners anyway, so Caiaphas had to send Jesus to the Roman governor, Pontius Pilate anyway. So he was sent to Pontius Pilate. He was tried through the night, which, by the way, is absolutely illegal also. Total mock trial. Absolute ludicrous. But in the end, we know that Jesus was sentenced to die, beaten, led outside of the city, and crucified. Caiaphas got his way. He preserved his power and his prestige and his position, and he kept his paycheck, and he kept his palace, and he kept all the peas. The only thing that he didn't have that truly mattered was a saving faith in Jesus Christ. And here's what's amazing and amazingly sad to me that I hope none of us ever do. As a high priest of God, called by God, used by God, somewhere along the way, it was no longer about God. Perhaps at one point it was, but his ministry and his life became about his agenda, about his glory, not about God's. This high priest was full of religion, but empty of God's spirit. It had no ability to lead him into all truth. That right there just proves that you can have absolute religion and no discernment and no relationship with Jesus Christ.
That's right.
He had Jesus. In fact, he had Jesus. He had truth incarnate right there in his home, right in front of him. But he never saw him as the way, the truth, and the life.
Come on. That's good.
And finally, the one major thing about this man, Caiaphas, was this. He spoke one famous sentence that he's known for. And in this sentence that I want to put up right here, this one sentence, he is known for speaking this one sentence. He literally uncovered the heart of the gospel without even knowing it. He said, "It is better for you that one man die for the people than the whole nation perish." This literally out of his mouth was the gospel. One man dies for all. The innocent dies for the guilty. The just dies for the unjust. Keep going, please. The Son of God took the place of sinners. He took the punishment. He suffered for our sins. He paid the price. Caiaphas spoke truth. He stared truth in the face. He even brought truth into his home. But he never let truth into his heart. And he never let it rule over his life. Don't be like Caiaphas. Please, let us never become like Caiaphas. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Every single one of us has the ability, if we are not checking our heart on a daily basis, to let stuff get in the way. Like Pastor said, oftentimes you and I, we want Jesus until it costs us something. Most of the time, it's preach it, Pastor, until we get to a verse that hurts a little bit. And then we want to take Bibles, if we had them like in the old days, where they were actually paper in front of us, and we want to rip that page out, that page on tithing, or that page on sacrifice, or that page on forgiving that person, or that page on obeying, or that page on submitting. And the fact of the matter is it costs us something. Prestige, power, paycheck, position, all of those things, yes. It most definitely will cost us our pet sins that we don't want to give up. Oh, those things that we want to hang on to just one more second. Oh, wait. Oh, I meant it, Jesus. I did. I just didn't mean yet. I want you to change my life. But don't take that. Jesus, restore that. But oh, don't make me do that. Don't make me go to her. Don't make me go to him. Don't make me change my heart. Don't make me give that up. And I know what it is because we've all been there. Every single one of us. And I believe that what God tells us through his word, showing us the life of Caiaphas, is this. That you and I, we can be religious. We can call ourselves Christians. We can come to church every Sunday. But what he's trying to say to us is this. Don't be like him. Where you convince yourself that you're doing it all for me, that you got it all together, that you and I are good. When I'm standing right in front of you and you're missing me. When you're ignoring me, when you're denying me, when you're walking past me. When I'm asking you one more time to see me and you're looking past me. See, guys, I know what it is to say, me and Jesus, we're tight. What I meant was that I knew that Jesus was following me around. And I called on him when I needed him. But when something was required of me, I wasn't listening. I pretended not to hear. Until I got to the point where I understood that everything that I need, everything that I want, it's in him. It's in him. So if you're here today and this message is for you, if you're like Caiaphas and the fact that your ears have grown to not hear his voice the way you used to. Perhaps you're really just not listening, unless it's something you want to hear. Done that too. This just jumped into my heart. This is for somebody today. The reason that you don't pray is not because you don't believe God can do it. The reason you stopped praying is because you don't want to hear what he tells you to do. and you're not willing just yet to do it. So you stopped asking. And God wants you to know right now that not only does He know, but He's asking you to trust Him one more time. He's literally standing there. He's knocking on the door to your heart, and He's saying, "Will you trust me?" Start praying about it again. Listen for what it is that I'm telling you to do, and then obey it. Walk it out and trust me. If I call you to it, I'll see you through it. If I ask you to do it, I'll give you the strength to do it. There's nothing that I'll call you to that I won't also enable you to do through my grace. If you'll trust me, that's how I work. That's for somebody today. He's here. And He is for you, not against you. And He is there with you. His calling, His anointing, His Spirit.
As every head is bowed and every eye closed, if this message applied to you and you got some Caiaphas in you that you need to get rid of, let me quickly tell you there's a place of prayer at this altar for you, and we'd love personally to partner with you in prayer. That anything that's holding you back and holding you down be removed. Once again, we all have some Caiaphas in us that we need to let go of. Let me say this, we're going to close. I love the fact that there's this picture in the Bible that's painted when they were in the courtyard and Peter had denied Christ. The Bible says he was by the fire warming himself. You know why? Because when you deny Christ, you get cold. You need a fire to heat you up. Maybe you haven't physically denied Him or with your words, but maybe we've denied Him in our actions, and therefore we find ourselves cold and indifferent, and we need the fire of God to warm our hearts one more time. But my question to you today is this. Are you here? And truth has been staring you in the face, but you haven't called on Him. That's the case. Today's your day. Today's your day. If you need Jesus as your Lord and Savior, today's your day. Don't walk out of this building not knowing truth when truth has been calling you the entire time. Are you here today? You said, "Man, I need to get some things right in my life." Let me quickly say, no one's going to judge you nor think anything bad about you if you find a place of prayer. If they do, that's between them and the Lord. Don't let that stop you. But if you're here today, there's something you need to pray about. These altars are open. And once again, we love the opportunity to pray for you. Get the crook out. Push Caiaphas out of the way. Walk with Christ. These altars are open.
Can I say this to you? None of us ever intend to be a hypocrite. Ever. But where the word hypocrite comes in, and that word that keeps coming to me, there's a word that keeps coming to me. It's the word incongruent. Several years ago, the word incongruent came to my spirit, and I began praying about it, and God said, "There's a lot that's incongruent in your life. And it's making you all out of balance. It's making you feel like a fraud. It's making you feel like a hypocrite. What you're saying and what you're doing is not the same. It's like saying you're a high priest, but then living as though you're not." So I want to ask you today, this is for somebody, are there some incongruencies in your life? Are you a man of God? Are you a Are you a servant of the Lord and yet you don't lead your family like one? Or are you a minister of the gospel but yet you don't respond to altar calls? Are you, and I want you to get that, because you see, I've been there. I understand what that is. We've all got to get to that place where we understand that we've got to be congruent. Are we leading our families, or are we just in a position? If we call ourselves a minister of the gospel, that's great. But that means that we have to act and serve like a minister of the gospel. And that means that we look at our family and we bring them all to church. And we make sure our families and our children are in church. You see, there are so many incongruencies that happen in our lives. And that's where the enemy gets in and says, see, you're a fraud. See, God's mad at you. See, he's not happy with you. And the reason why you don't ever feel like you're pleasing God is because you've let a doorway in where the enemy can get in there and convince you God's mad at you. You shut that door so that the enemy's got nothing to accuse you with. You be congruent in every area of your life. What you say and what you do, line them up for Jesus. What you say and what you do and how you walk and what the Word of God says, line those up in the name of Jesus. And every time the enemy shows up to accuse you, you tell him where to go, because those words do not apply here any longer.